Today we welcome a filmmaker whose documentary and fiction films have screened at over 100 film festivals worldwide, and most recently on HBO. When not making award-winning films, Cheryl Ferjanik works as a documentary instructor at New York University and consults on crowdfunding, audience building, and fan relationships. She's now reaching monumental success with her most recent film, Back on Board, The Story of Greg Louganis. Let's take a look.
And now to the man, his last dive in these Olympics. He needs 81.92 to break 700 points. Nobody's ever done that. That is the Mount Everest of this sport.
You don't know why. You don't know where it's coming from. You don't know the motivation behind it. But a performance in diving is and should be as emotional as any incredibly written play.
Scored before, gets the goal.
He could be the greatest diver ever to dive.
Well, let's dive in with Cheryl Ferjanik. Welcome to Studio A.
Thanks for having me.
So what compelled you to tell the Greg Louganis story?
I've always been a huge fan of the Olympics ever since I was young, and we would watch them growing up, and it was just, I was in awe always of the competitions and the athletes. And a few years ago, a friend of mine from film school, Will Sweeney, we were in touch, and he said, you know, I just read this article that Greg Louganis is returning to diving after having been away from the sport for 20 years, and he's coming back as a coach and a mentor, and I, you know, what's the story there? And let's investigate that, and let's make a movie. And I had made a documentary previously called Sink or Swim about the Olympic synchronized swimming team. Mm-hmm. So it was something that kind of overlapped with that previous film thematically in some ways. And, you know, we read the article. It was interesting. We read his autobiography, which was incredibly compelling. And one thing we realized while doing that and chatting with folks about the film that we wanted to make, especially younger folks, is that they had no idea who Greg was, mm-hmm. especially if they were 27 or under. That mm-hmm. was our kind of informal, unscientific poll. Mm-hmm. And what we thought was that, you know, he was so iconic and important and impressive to us, you know, kind of growing up and to so many people, and for a younger generation, a whole generation of people to kind of not have heard his name before mm-hmm. felt kind of, you know, like in some ways a wrong that needed to be righted. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. we reached out to him, and he kind of graciously said yes, that we could make this movie, and we began. And so part of the important part for us in some way was not only to tell his current day story of what he was doing now, but also to kind of solidify his legacy for people and tell his story and solidify the legacy in sports history, LGBT history, the history of AIDS and HIV, mm-hmm. And just American history in general. So we set out to do that with him.
Yeah, I mean, you really captured a story that crosses so many different compelling storylines. What's it like to work with an athlete who's also been in front of the camera for so much of his life?
That was definitely something that took a little while to figure out mm-hmm. with my relationship with him. He, you know, the first time we sat down for an interview, you know, he's been answering questions about his life for 25 plus years, mm-hmm. for much longer than that actually, but that's since the 88 Olympics, so even longer than that. And he's been documented since he's been a little kid. Mm-hmm. So he's sort of used to having a public persona. And the first time we sat down for an interview, he answered these questions very beautifully. He's an incredibly skilled interviewee and incredibly skilled at answering questions. And, you know, we went back and we were like, oh, that went so well. Mm-hmm. And then I began to do, you know, some more archival footage research and listen to the way he answered questions for other people. And it was very, very similar. And what I realized was that this was kind of his story that he's been narrating of himself for many, many years. And so it took a while for us to kind of hit a place with our relationship where he realized that it wasn't just us showing up for one, you know, interview for a journalism piece or something and then leaving. We were going to keep coming back. And so it was, how do I ask the questions differently so he answers them differently? And how do we develop our relationship so he trusts me to answer them in a, perhaps a deeper way or a different way? Mm-hmm. And part of my process for that was, you know, I live in New York, he lives in L.A., so every week we would chat on the phone for an hour or so, and I would get to know him better, and we would kind of figure out what else we wanted to shoot and what was going on. So by the time we sat down again for the on-camera interview, kind of I knew more about, you know, maybe where to go with the questions or how to get to some of the answers that I wanted.
Mm-hmm. So I want to show a clip that shows a bit of the context in which Greg was diving in and then later some of the issues he faced. Can you set this clip up for us?
Sure. I mean, I think one thing people really remember about Greg, first and foremost, is his incredible diving career and his success as an Olympian, an Olympic champion. But some folks don't always remember or vaguely remember the details around when he came out as gay and HIV positive in the mid-1990s with his book Breaking the Surface. And this was still, you know, Ellen came out in 97. This was like still really pretty early time to come out. And he did this, you know, publicly with this book and was afraid at the time that he might lose everything by doing so. So this kind of sets up the climate in America in which he came out in. Another part of the film, we talk about also what the feelings were for people of people towards folks who were HIV positive, and they were not good at all. So there was an LA Times poll that we show in the film at one point that says, you know, 50% of people polled think people who are HIV positive should be quarantined. You know, and to think about that now is just appalling.
Yeah, it's hard to believe that.
It's hard to believe. Yeah. But it was important for us to kind of set that context. What are the stakes for Greg, kind of emotionally, financially, for him to be coming out in the ways that he did at that time? And that's the clip you'll see.
All right, well, let's look at the clip.
My name is Greg Louganis. I'm gay, and I'm HIV positive.
A man considered to be the greatest diver in Olympic history has announced today that he has AIDS.
If it had been almost any other disease, everyone would be talking about his courage. But it was the AIDS virus, and it was the dive Louganis missed on his way to that medal that everyone's talking about now.
We checked with the International Olympic Committee, and they said that Greg was under no obligation to divulge his secret even after he hit his head on the board.
Would it have been this complicated, say, if you were not this, you know, the greatest diver of all times in the history of the world, since there ever was a diving board?
I had every expectation that if I went public with the fact that I'm gay, that no one would want to hire me and that I would lose my house.
How would a smart guy like you practice unsafe sex?
I'm not following.
How'd you get AIDS?
I'm sure I was probably exposed before they knew about unsafe sex.
Oh, so you're pretty sure of that?
Yeah.
You feel in yourself that you might live a long while?
Yeah, I think so. I hope so.
You're confident. Well, think or hope is a different thing. Are you confident that you will?
Who knows?
You know, the shame, the guilt, you know, all of this stuff that I was feeling. I knew, you know, if I were going through that, that I probably wasn't the only one, that, you know, there were probably others out there. I just didn't know that there were that many.
It's a very effective clip. So how have you seen opinions and popular opinions on HIV/AIDS change since the time that he outed himself as homosexual and positive? And also, like, what's been the experience in audiences as the film has been screening?
You know, it's interesting. I think, you know, Greg came out again in the mid-90s. Just after he came out, there were major advances in HIV meds that saved quite a few people's lives. And he was one of the lucky ones who managed to live through that before those meds came out. And surprisingly, I think, to him in some ways, despite Larry King's kind of horrendous clip there, people were, by and large, very, very supportive of him, very moved by his courage in coming out, which I think, you know, is actually, fast forward to us releasing the film, is reflected also in the response that we've been getting now after the film's release, and that people are sort of reminded that in the climate that Greg was living, that him coming out was actually quite courageous and quite brave, and that, you know, now he's getting kind of this resurgence of recognition, this resurgence of kind of support from audiences, you know, across the country who have seen the film and they either had no idea who he was and they're so thrilled to learn about him and learn about, you know, folks who have come before them who kind of set the tone and the pace for kind of other folks who are LGBT. Mm-hmm. He really is, I think, kind of feeling that people do remember who he is in ways that are, I think, quite profound for him. To feel that kind of support from you know, people. He says, you know, he's always gotten recognized, but sort of the number of times he gets recognized now, but after the film's been on HBO, has gone up quite a bit. And you know, I've been with him. We were out to breakfast one day, and people were like, "Oh my God, you're Greg Louganis!" And you know, so it's still people are quite moved to be able to actually see him in person too, mm-hmm. and that's pretty amazing to see, whether it's after a Q&A or just walking along the street and sort of realize that this is the man they saw, you know, on television while he was diving, and then go through all of these things while he came out and kind of emerge on the other side, you know, in some ways a lot stronger of a person than he was before even.
Do you think the Wheaties box movement is part of that?
Yeah, a woman from Chicago, after she saw our film, you know, there's a scene in the film where Greg talks about not having gotten a Wheaties box, and that he attributes that to, at the time, you know, rumors that he was gay. And someone from Chicago, this woman, Julie, kind of saw that and was outraged and started a change.org petition, which quickly picked up steam, was supported, you know, by different LGBT organizations. The New York Times picked it up and wrote about it. Upworthy picked it up and wrote about it, and it gained steam and was up to something like 40,000 signatures when, you know, change.org and Julie called us and talked to us about how they were going to physically go and deliver the petition to General Mills, which they did, and had a nice conversation with General Mills, who isn't promising anything but says they will kind of revisit, you know, what Greg's importance was. And the petition's still up. It's now up to 50,000 signatures, I think. But that's something that I think is very tangible that people can respond to in a way, right? So you can't sort of say, you know, well, Greg should have gotten more, right? The more is kind of intangible, but a Wheaties box is a thing you can hold in your hand and, you know, put on your breakfast table. So for, I think it's something that is easy for people to kind of get behind because it's an actionable item too, that they can, this is how we can hopefully help to kind of right this wrong. And again, it's just such an icon of kind of athletic success in our country, mm-hmm. that Greg, having not been on it, with the amount of success that he achieved in his career, does feel like this incredible slight. And, you know, fingers crossed, mm-hmm. it'll happen one day.
Yeah. I mean, let's, like, put the face of homophobia and stigma to rest, mm-hmm. through the cereal box. it's hard to believe that that's possible, but yeah. Yes, I signed. your other film is also about water sports. You mentioned it earlier. Can you talk about Sink or Swim?
Sure. In 2000, I was watching the Olympics, as I tend to do, because I love it, and I saw synchronized swimming probably for the first time. And in my house, we kind of turn on the TV when the Olympics starts, and kind of more or less don't turn it off for two weeks. And I saw synchronized swimming, and I was thinking, what is this, and how do they do it, and are they walking on the bottom, and this is kind of mesmerizing. Even though I don't really understand it, I can't tear my eyes away. And I thought, oh, that would make a great documentary, I think. And I certainly didn't understand what the sport was. But I, as I tend to do, I sort of get this idea and it stays there until I do something about it. And I reached out to the Olympic team by way of their media relations person. And I said, hey, I want to make this movie. And they're like, okay. And I was like, okay, I guess I'm making this documentary about your Olympic team. Mm-hmm. And we started making the film. And I think what one thing that people, again, don't realize, and I certainly didn't when I started making the film, was that it looks like it's easy, right? Their job is to make it look very, very easy. And instead, what I found was that these are incredible athletes who are very good at what they do. And then the same way that, you know, Greg makes his sport look easy, they make their sport look easy. So the scene is a scene of Olympic trials that the swimmers are going through. And one thing that we chose to put it together this way because we actually had quite a few clips of swimming. We had many, many scenes at the pool. And so one reason we put this together this way is a different way to kind of approach a montage. So we decided we wanted to, how would we compress time and show lots of different swimmers competing in this trial? You know, the judging that was going on and the teammates along the side of the pool who had already made the team cheering them on. And so we decided to do this as well. And how do you kind of line all of these different folks who are competing at the same time? And we wanted to show, you know, again, prove to folks who still didn't believe it that what was going on below the water was not walking on the bottom of the pool, but instead this like incredible athletic skill. And so that's what came out of it.
I mean, it's incredible. You show these people that look so elegant and effortless as the real athletes that they are. And you're drawn to water sports, but sports. Mm-hmm. What is it about sports documentaries? Why do they connect with such a wide audience?
It's funny, I didn't mean to start making sports movies necessarily, but synchronized swimming was something that really caught my attention and just kind of took hold very deeply, and I kind of didn't let me go until I dealt with it. And it became a way to talk about, especially women's sports, that are not appreciated as much as men's sports on the whole, but then specifically this sport in general, or this sport specifically. Mm-hmm. And you know, many other things happened during the course of making that film that are much, much deeper than you might think would be this kind of lighthearted romp through synchronized swimming. And it became a way, and that film, and especially Back on Board, became a way to really get at other social issues through a sports movie. So for anyone who, you know, folks who think they're coming to watch this movie about, you know, diving or the Olympics, and then they get all of these other things that are layered throughout the film. Right, so it's Greg dealing with homophobia, Greg dealing with bullying when he was a kid, his financial issues as a result of some of these things that he's gone through, and you know there's kind of ways that you get to get at other really important and educational things, I think, through sports films that, you know, you sort of sneak it in for folks who think they're in it for the ride of the competition. And then there's this other layer or several layers underneath where you really just get to tell other kinds of stories through that.
Mm-hmm. So you've made two feature docs that have done very, very well, and a short documentary on a bra store called
That's correct.
The Good Uplift, which is so adorable. If you can say that about a documentary, it's adorable. What makes a good documentary director?
It's a great question. For me, I think it's all about relationships. So, you know, in its most fundamental level, a documentary is, in a lot of ways, a recording of relationships, right? So it's my relationship with the person I'm filming with, the person in front of the camera, my relationship with the crew's relationship with that person that we're shooting the movie with, the crew's relationship with the equipment, and how we all kind of come together and do this work. And these are relationships that have to be grown and nurtured, you know, throughout the entire process of making the film. And so for me, it's about a director who can make these connections with people and, you know, treat them very well and, you know, hope to get kind of the best performances out of them, performances if you can call it that, but, you know, to have someone open up for you in front of the camera is quite a special relationship, and it's not to be taken lightly, and, you know, there's an incredible amount of trust there for the person who's opening up to you. So it's about, for me, it's about, you know, building these relationships and maintaining them throughout time, you know, before, during, and after the film is completed, and you know, having a sense of what the story is, of course, but for me, it fundamentally comes down to those relationships.
Mm. Thank you. So we have other questions. I don't get to ask all of them now. So there are other people here, thankfully, who have some questions to ask. Who's first?
What are some of the most effective ways of getting your films distributed?
I think it depends what your goal is for the film. So thinking about that when you start a film. So if it's going to be a short film, that's going to be like the best 3-minute film you've ever seen on, I saw one recently on how folks who do projection of actual film, actual celluloid, is kind of going by the wayside. And it was a brilliant, brilliant 3-minute documentary. And it's on Vimeo, and it does very well there. It's probably got, you know, hundreds of thousands of views. If you're making a feature documentary, you might want to try to think about distributing it elsewhere to get a different kind of audience. I don't know that there is one best way. I think it's sort of, you know, figuring out what the best fit is, right? So if, like, you're given a whole bag of tools and someone's like, there's this job I want you to do, and you have to figure out what tool you need to do that job, right? So it really depends. But I think these days there are a lot more opportunities to kind of take very big movies and put them in places where they didn't used to live. So I think that's important also, to just kind of keep an open mind about what's the best fit, right? What's the best tool for this job?
Mm-hmm. And HBO was a pretty good tool.
That was a good tool. That's not a bad tool. That's exactly right.
Who else has a question?
So what was it about living and going to school in New York City that shaped your film style?
Oh, that's a great question. So I was an undergrad film student there many years ago, and I've been working in film and teaching film in New York ever since. I really thrive on the kind of, you know, lowercase c chaos of New York City, and how, you know, I was talking to someone earlier about, they're like, what do you like about New York? I was like, I kind of like that there are things that are open 24 hours a day. Mm. I go to bed early, but knowing that there's a hardware store where I can get stuff at 4 in the morning seems important to me. That doesn't affect the filmmaking, of course, but it, as a sort of hub of arts and culture, you know, we have films and filmmakers coming through that you would never see elsewhere. You know, every day you could be going out to see different art and different films, and really kind of learn from what's there. And I really also love teaching, and so that's something that I get to do in New York as well. And that feeds the films I make, and I think the films I make feed the teaching. So it's hard to imagine being elsewhere outside of New York City and having that same energy that I really kind of thrive on.
All right, I think we have another question.
In your experience, what are some important skills that film graduates need to develop?
That's a great question. I think, you know, one of my mentors, Judith Helfand, who's a documentary filmmaker, said this about grant writing, and I think it goes for a lot of other kinds of filmmaking. No doesn't mean no. No means later, right? So you apply for something, you apply for a film festival, you apply for a grant, you ask someone if you can make a movie about them, and if you're really passionate about doing it, no is not an answer that you will accept, right? So I think this is something that's very important. And, you know, I have from my very first films I made in film school that I was sending out to festivals, I have a folder still called Festivals Entered, and I should rename it Rejection Letters, because that's all it is, right? It's just a stack of rejection letters. But it was important to me to know that that's part of this process. So when students of mine come to me and say, oh, I applied for a film festival and I got rejected, and I said, welcome to the club. You know, this is part of what this is, right? Learning from mistakes, you know, don't give up. And then also seeking out opportunities, I think, is really important. Also, can you crew up with folks who are making films that you really admire, right? Part of the reason I was excited to work with Judith Helfand right out of film school was I really liked her films. And she ended up having a job opening, and it just worked out that way, right? It worked out really beautifully that I got to go and learn from this person whose movies I really, really admired. And so I think just not giving up is really, really important.
Did you work on Blue Vinyl?
I did. I was an associate producer on Blue Vinyl.
Oh, so good. So good and funny.
Yeah. 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 But that was a case, too, where she had been still touring with her last film, A Healthy Baby Girl, and I was just out of film school, and she would say, all right, we have to go shoot in Louisiana. I have to go to a screening, so you take the crew there and shoot for the first few days, and then I'll be there after that. I was like, okay, this is, you know, trial by fire. I'm going to go and do this. And it was a great experience, and I learned a ton. And the fact that she, you know, who I really respected, would trust me with her film and her vision was really incredible, mm-hmm. and gave me a great sense of kind of confidence, I think, moving forward as well.
Mm. I love that idea, like, we're all a community of people who won't take no for an answer. So who else has a question?
I was wondering, how do you organize a shooting schedule for a film like Back on Board?
Oh, wow. Yes. So as I mentioned before, I'm in New York. Greg's in LA. And part of it was literally, what's the story we're telling of the present day? So at the very beginning of the film, we thought the story was going to be about Greg coaching this kids' dive team. We're like, oh, we'll tell, you know, what season of the dive team, and that's how we'll tell the story, and that's how we'll organize the shoots, practices and meets and things like that. And quickly what happened was that he quit that job. We're like, wow, that's not the story we're telling, after all. But we were very, very committed to telling the historical piece, the biographical pieces that people kind of knew about but didn't necessarily know very deeply. So that was something we were committed to doing. And then also, so what became this, the driving force of the schedule was, well, what is he doing now? And does that seem like it fits in with this film? And so whether it was stuff happening with his finances and trying to save his house, which is in the film, or, you know, mentoring the Olympic team, you know, I would spend time on the phone with him and sort of say, well, what are you up to? You know, what's your schedule look like? And he would tell me, and I'd say, oh, well, is that something we can shoot? And so part of it was, you know, this kind of, as it comes up, stuff that was happening and serendipity for, are we going to be in the right place at the right time to get something really great? And some of it was, this is coverage we need because, you know, it's going to help us tell the story of his past. So it was a combination of things. It, you know, I think some filmmakers might make a schedule that's very rigid and can stay that way in some ways, depending on the film you're making. But for this, that was sort of stuff unfolding over time, and we didn't know which way it was going. We had to be a little bit open to the direction things might go. So we had some things we knew we wanted to cover, and like the Olympics, for example, since he was mentoring that team. But then also along the way, it was, okay, well, you know, what are you doing now? And a lot of that stuff we shot as we tried to figure out what the story was didn't end up in the film. It was great to shoot it, and it's going to be DVD extras. But you know, it's hard. It's you, a lot of it's you have to be open to kind of changing what you're shooting. And the thing that I tell my students is that, you know, these films, we have an idea and we pitch this idea in class or wherever, and you go out and you shoot and you come back and then you sort of hit the refresh button, right? And you're like, what is my film about now? And you go out and shoot and come back with the footage and you say, well, what is my film about now? Because the only thing the audience is going to see is what's on screen. They're not going to know that, oh, I tried really hard to get the shoot of Greg doing this, but it didn't work out. That's not what you stand up and say before you show your finished movie, right? So all the audience sees is what's on screen. So as you go along and you shoot your movie, it's what is my movie about now? And so the proposal you turn at the beginning of class will probably look very different from the film you make at the end. And it's because, again, this is a living, breathing thing that we're doing, right, with other humans who are changing their minds and you know, doing other things. And so what we're doing is we're trying to kind of figure out if we can tell a story we want to tell that kind of also fits into this real-life circumstance. And how do we make that work? And that's sort of, we end up with hopefully a documentary at the end of this, right, and a story that works. Yeah, it's I think season to taste depending on the film you're making for the schedule, but that's how we went about doing this one.
Thank you.
Sure.
Yeah, you're like orchestrating real life.
That's right. That's right.
Cheryl, thank you for sharing your process with us. It's been a pleasure to have you here and learn from you and your great films.
Thanks for having me.